So welcome everyone. We're happy to have Olga today for her second lecture on neutrino cosmology. And you see that most of us are already back from coffee. So Olga, please take it away.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here again with you. So yesterday we finished with this hands-on session, right? With this code, or I recommend you to install it and to play with that. I think that is extremely useful. And today we are gonna go back and continue. And as I promise you, I don't know why this is frozen. Let me see. Ah, now, okay. So we are gonna go to point five here, cosmology and neutrino masses. So now we are starting again in the in the same point, right? This is like a spacecraft, right? We are having a trip along the story of the universe. So we continue where we stop, in the cosmic microwave background, right? Yesterday we learned how to infer an effective from cosmic microwave background measurements. Today we're gonna learn how to infer neutrino masses from the cosmic microwave background measurements when the temperature of the universe was around 0.3 eV and the universe was 300,000 years old, okay? So traditionally, there are two effects in the CMB caused by neutrino masses. One is the early integrated Maxwell effect, which affects here the first peak, ISW effect. And the second one is an horizontal shift of the peaks, right? Here you can see as I increase the neutrino mass, the first peak is decreased, right? From 0.51 to 2 eV is decreased, clearly. The red case is the one in which is more suppressed. And then there is also an horizontal shift that way, okay? Let me start with the CMB early integrated Maxwell effect. So this formula has different terms, okay? This is the final photon temperature we are measuring, okay? The deviations from the mean 2.725. There are several terms here. One is the initial perturbation, the other one is the gravitational potential, the other one is the Doppler term, but for us, the most important one is this one, okay? It's the integral along of side of the potentials, gravitational potentials, okay? So in matter domination, notice that this is time derivative. This dot means time derivative. When the universe is dominated by matter, the gravitational potential is constant. So this term is not present because there is not the time derivative of these potentials are zero, okay? However, when the neutrinos are radiation, are still relativistic, they contribute to this term. So depending if neutrinos are relativistic or non-relativistic at CMB period, they will leave an imprint here or not, okay? So they will contribute or not, depending if they are relativistic or not. So this early ISW effect leads to a depletion in the CMB peaks of, for instance, for one EV mass will be 10%. It's not very big, but still there is a big deviation. And remember that around the first peak, Planck and WMAP before have measured really, really well the photon anisotropies, okay? Notice that this effect contributes mostly in the first peak, that is on multiples between 20 and 200. You can see this in this plot. The ISW effect is this effect here, right? Here, down here, okay? And then it's around the first peak in this range of multiples, okay? So you can see here how, as I increase the neutrino mass, the first peak goes down, okay? As I have shown you before, okay? It's not a very huge effect, but it still is there, okay? Depending on how massive are the neutrinos, how relativistic or non-relativistic are they, okay? The second is a shift, right? It's a shift towards larger scales, right? Smaller L's, right? Induced by the contribution of the neutrinos to the angular diameter distance. What we are measuring, the angular position of the peaks depends on RS, that is the sound horizon at recombination, divided by the distance from us to the last scattering surface, okay, dA. This dA is inversely proportional to h of c. So if I increase the neutrino mass, I increase h of c. dA is smaller, okay, and theta s will be larger. So they shift towards larger angular scales. Larger angular scales are larger scales, right? Okay, smaller multiples, okay? So the higher the neutrino mass is, the lower the angular diameter distance. But consider that this will be strongly degenerate with IH0, because I can increase the Hubble parameter by increasing the neutrino masses, but I can decrease H0, okay? And this can be clearly seen in this plot. Notice this is the Hubble constant in kilometers per second per megaparsecs versus the neutrino mass, okay? You can see that I can compensate here the neutrino mass bluish is lightest and reddish is highest values of the neutrino mass. I can always compensate a larger value of the neutrino mass with a lower value of H0, okay? So there is a strong degeneracy. So concerning these two traditional effects, mostly are cancelled. So I mean, due to parameter degeneracy, okay? So you will tell me, and how CMB measures then the neutrino mass, because Planck puts very strong constraints. Okay, to avoid this, we have fortunately a second anisotropy, a secondary anisotropy that is CMB lensing, okay? Lensing. So CMB photons will get distorted along the path due to the presence of matter inhomogeneities. We know this, right? The gravitational lensing. As you know, Einstein relativity predicts that the presence of a massive body will curve the space-time, right? And it will distort the light trajectory. And the shape of the background objects will be distorted. Instead of being spherical, they will look elliptical. Instead of being just one, will be plenty of them, right? And will change or will be multiplied. And we can see this in this picture. I'm gonna show you here something cool. This is a movie. So it's a movie, and then there is a lensing galaxy, us, and behind there is a quasar moving. So you're gonna see that when the alignment between the source, which is the quasar, the lens that is the galaxy between us and the quasar and us, is a perfect alignment. This is something called psi CG here, psi CG. Okay, it's a term called psi CG. That instead of looking of seeing just one source, we are gonna see a ring. These are the so-called Einstein rings. Okay, so let me see this one. Ah, perfect. So I mean, there is a quasar moving behind a spiral galaxy. You see, when the alignment is perfect, we are gonna see a beautiful ring here. These are the so-called Einstein rings. Okay, can you see it? It's amazing. So we know that gravitational lensing exists, right? And let me see if I can. Okay, this is amazing. This is a double Einstein ring. This has been measured by the Hubble telescope, okay? So you see here one Einstein ring and another Einstein ring in bluish. One inside, right here, and then one outside. There are probably less than 100 cases in the universe, and we have been able to observe one. So I mean, CMB light, the CMB photons are light and will also get distorted, right? By they are traveling from the last scattering surface to us, and they will encounter all type of matter inhomogeneities. So what does CMB lensing? It produces a remapping of the CMB fluctuations, okay? So, and this remapping, right? This is the direction of the photons is affected, right? By the gradient of the lensing potential. The lensing potential measures both the matter distribution and the geometry, okay? It's proportional, it's an integral of the matter distribution, the gravitational potential, and the geometry. And this is the power spectrum, okay? Of the lensing potential. But as I've been telling you since we started with neutrinos, neutrinos are hot thermal relics with very, very large velocity dispersion, thermal velocities, implying less clustering at small scales. And therefore they will reduce CMB lensing, okay? And here I show you a plot where you can see, right, clearly from this reference, the lensing potential, the amount of lensing, let's say, as a function of the neutrino mass here. So you can see that the lensing drops clearly from the lambda CDM case, really drops as a function of L, as the neutrino mass increases. And there is a beautiful plot here from the Planck collaboration in the first data release, where you can see that as I increase the neutrino mass, that is that lighter colors, right? I increase the lensing. So then, I mean, I can measure neutrino masses with CMB because CMB experiments measure also CMB lensing, extract the CMB lensing, okay? So, what is the limit from Planck alone, from temperature and polarization and CMB lensing? Planck tells us that the neutrino mass should be smaller than 0.024 eV, okay? But by far, the largest imprint of neutrino masses in the cosmological observables is that induced in the large scale structure of the universe. Now we are getting close to our period. Now the universe is 1 giga year, and the first stars and the first galaxies start forming, right? The large scale structures start forming, and this is super important. Neutrinos suppress structure formation larger than the free streaming scale when they turn non-relativistic, okay? Why? Because neutrinos with EV or sub-EV masses are hot relics, hot thermal relics with large thermal velocities. Colder matter instead has zero velocity, and therefore it clusters at any scale, even at a very, very small scales, as I was telling you yesterday. Even in very, very small galaxies, as the large or small Magellanic clouds, right? Very small scales, dark matter is able to collapse, okay? Because it has zero velocity, so there is no pressure, okay? So let me explain you this better. This is something I have stolen from our friend Yvonne Wong, okay? I'll tell you something here. So if in this situation, the wavelength of the gravitational potential perturbation is much smaller than the neutrino free streaming scale in terms of lambda, right? Or in terms of K, just the opposite, the wave number, neutrinos won't cluster. Because neutrinos have this thermal velocity and won't cluster, won't contribute to the gravitational potential wells, won't felt into the gravitation, won't be attracted by the gravitational well, potential well. Instead, if the wavelength of the perturbation is much larger than the neutrino free streaming scale, neutrinos will contribute clustering. Okay, but what is this free streaming scale that sounds so difficult and so impossible to understand? No way, it's super easy. I don't know if you have seen perturbation theory, but yesterday we saw the Friedman equations, okay? These were background equations, but as you know, the universe has perturbations, right? I mean, the structure has grown, right? So, and now has gone already into the non-linear regime, right? But let's start in the linear regime. This is the matter perturbation, okay? This is what it does, what does matter to cluster, the matter perturbation. This here is the Hubble term, the Hubble friction, let's say, okay? So the Hubble friction, what it does, it's a friction, okay? Opposes to clamping, right? I mean, then we have two terms. One that is the pressure term, that also, of course, opposes clamping, and then the gravity term, right? And gravity, of course, favors clustering. So it's a competition, always is a competition. The universe, it's a competition between pressure and gravity, okay? In such a way that usually in a structure formation, we define a scale that is called the Jeans scale. That is defined as the ratio of the gravity term to this term here, okay? To the term, well, CS squared is the sound speed of the fluid, okay? So, of course, the sound speed has here a very important role. The larger it is, the more powerful the pressure will be, and the more difficult will be structure to cluster and to grow, okay? So if this happens, no growth can occur, but if the opposite happens, okay, density perturbations grow. So the neutrino free streaming scale is exactly the same, right? You see this expression, okay? I have used here the definition of H, that's it. The definition of the Hubble parameter, but that's it. It's just replacing this CS square by the neutrino thermal velocity, okay? That's it. Square root of 3/2 because H square is 8 pi J rho over 3. So I need a factor here of 3/2 because I have only 4 and not an 8 pi, okay? So, okay, it's just that. So it's super simple. I mean, when I was always listening to this free neutrino streaming scale when I was a student, and then one day I said, I have to understand this. I mean, it can't be so difficult. And it is super easy. I mean, it's just a competition between pressure and gravity and which of them can win, okay? So let's make here a parenthesis. If you want to compute it yourself, this expression, it's super easy. You have the Fermi-Dirac distribution for the neutrinos, and then you have to just to compute the velocity dispersion. You take the Fermi-Dirac distribution, integrate P squared over M, weighted by this function, by the Fermi-Dirac, and divided, of course, to normalize by the Fermi-Dirac distribution, and you will get this this thermal motion, okay? This neutrino dispersion velocities, and you compute here, and this is the free streaming scale. So let's look to this, what it means, okay? This means that this is the power spectrum. You have seen this plot, right? These are smaller scales, right? These are smaller scales, okay? So this is a movie. There will be a suppression. I'm gonna now improve, I'm gonna increase, sorry, the fraction of mass in the universe in the form of neutrinos. You will see how the power spectrum, right? Can you see this? Sorry, let's see it again. So when I change from zero massive neutrinos to one, that is all the dark matter in the universe is made by neutrinos, you see that this is a huge reduction at the small scale. So the reduction is proportional to the amount of matter in the universe in the form of massive neutrinos. And the effect for a 1 eV neutrino is much, much larger than the effect in the CMB. It's 100%, okay? So I mean, realize that is a huge effect, much larger. There is a suppression of delta P over P of the power spectrum at the smallest case induced by the neutrinos, okay? So here you can see this suppression, right? For 0 eV, for 0.3 eV, and the suppression, right, is proportional to the neutrino mass. Be careful. Life seems beautiful, but of course, life is not so beautiful sometimes, of course. Why? Because this is all true in linear theory, but we know that at some point, the perturbations go non-linear. There are mode couplings, right? Each mode does not evolve independently, okay? So mess, right? So there is a scale, and here I show you the power spectrum as measured by the Bose the Sloan Digital Sky Survey 3, not 4, this is previous data, at a ratio of 0.6 roughly. And you can see that data release 9 and data release 12, okay? And you can see that at these scales at which neutrinos are important, 0.1 here, we are already in the nonlinearity. So, one problem. And in the nonlinear regime, we don't know super well. We have methods, of course, and we are able to compute the power spectrum, but it's not as simple and as straightforward as in the linear regime, okay? So the neutrino signal is in the matter power spectrum is in a region that is a bit complicated, okay? We know how to model that, but it's not as straightforward as it seems. Another caveat, bias, okay. We are not observing dark matter. Dark matter is invisible, right? We are observing galaxies. Yes, galaxies are formed in the dark matter halos, right? But we don't observe the dark matter directly. So galaxies are biased tracers of the underlying dark matter field. There is a bias here, and neutrinos themselves introduce another bias. So, you know, we have to marginalize over the bias. Life is not so simple. Fortunately, yes, there is a way out. Why? Because we can measure the power spectrum or the large scale structure features either in its safe form, as I show you, this power spectrum, right? Or in the form of baryon acoustic oscillations. What are baryon acoustic oscillations? What is this VOO signature, okay? So as I mentioned yesterday, and as I show you in this plot where photons and baryons were tightly coupled, you remember, right, that they were like right in the potential hills and in the potential wells. So photons and baryons in the early universe are tightly coupled, and again it's a game between pressure and gravity. Okay, there will be a time in which baryons are released from this drag of photons. This is known as the drag epoch. Then the baryons are stuck, right? Photons are freely to travel and baryons get stuck at a given scale. This is the scale that is determined by the size of the horizon at the drag epoch, okay? This RS here, okay? So this RS is the distance that a sound wave can travel in the both photon baryon fluid since the beginning of the universe until the drag epoch, when photons and baryons decouple, okay? And it's 147 megaparsecs. I show you here this animation. So at some point, they are coupled, right? But it gets frozen at this scale, okay? It gets frozen, this. So here an animation, let me see if it works, the animation, okay. So I'm gonna start. This is from the beginning of the universe, okay? All perturbations are together, you see? when the universe was only 110 years, imagine, I mean, was a baby, okay? Now it's 14 giga years at a very, very high resi. So we have all the perturbations together, dark matter, gas, photon, neutrino. Of course, now we are going to see that dark matter stays there, right? The red one. And gas, baryons, and photons are together. Neutrinos decouple, we know very early, and that's it. But you see, right, that baryons, at some point, I will show you again this movie, baryons is gas, okay, the baryonic matter, right? You see that they go together with photons. At some point, photons start freely traveling as neutrinos do. And there is a peak here because baryons get frozen at a scale that is basically 147 megaparsecs. This is the so-called baryon acoustic oscillations, okay? So what does it mean practically, right? Okay, this is the sound horizon, sound wave, due to the photon baryon fluid that is tightly coupled, and at some point, photons decouple, baryons get frozen. What does it mean for us? This means that around a given galaxy, for each given galaxy, there should be an excess in the two-point correlation function. That is what I just shown you, okay? This peak, the first peak is the dark matter one, and then the second one, located at zero, in the middle of the galaxy, of course, where dark matter is. But there should be also a very small, or a tiny, or a clustering around this typical scale, okay? Okay, an excess. Okay, what have we measured this? Okay, in the 80s, it was impossible, because the surveys were very small. I mean, so basically the VS scale was the size of the survey, so no way of seeing a clustering around a given galaxy. In the 2000, around the 2000, we had a quite big number already, Sloan Digital Sky Survey started, but this volume was very small. In 2005, you see that this is the typical value of scale compared to the size of the survey, what the survey is observing, and this is this 147 megaparsecs. So of course, surveys, as time goes on, start to be able to see more and more and more due to, of course, of technology of telescopes, spectroscopy, and such, okay? So you can see that there is a big volume. This was the first detection of the VO signature in 2005, okay? So you can clearly see now here this beautiful peak, right? And how the neutrinos affect the position of this peak, okay? So large scale structure can be measured either interpreted, sorry, here is on top of this, either in the geometrical or safe form, okay? So the two-point correlation function here, or the matter power spectrum, and one is the Fourier transform of the other. The advantage of baryon acoustic oscillations is that they are much less subject to nonlinearities, okay? So it's much better for the neutrinos, right? And this is something that we explore, that VO information is more powerful, okay? So you can see here the 1D probability distribution of the neutrino mass, okay? For either a PK in this form or VAU, right? Look, these are the solid lines compared to the dashed ones. You see that the limits on the neutrino mass here compare the red solid line with the red dashed one. It's much better in this case, in the dashed one, than in the solid case, because we are exploring the information in this way, not in this one. So we are less subject to biases and to nonlinearities, okay? Okay? Perfect, sorry. So Planck, CMB measurements. 0.24 due to lensing. If we add VO information, we go down to 0.12. So really large scale structure is crucial to measure the neutrino masses, okay? So here is this plot that I showed you before. As a function of the mass of the lightest neutrino, the total sum of the neutrino masses, okay? So we have, as we know, there should be at least two massive neutrinos. We don't know the lightest one, how massive it is. Is it? In the normal ordering, we know that the mass should be larger than 0.06, basically, and in the inverted 0.1. So we have basically, we have 0.12, 0.13 here, 0.11 if we add supernovae data. And this limit is the latest one from Sloan Digital Sky Survey 4. Go down to 0.10, basically 0.0990, with CMB, SDS, VAO, and supernovae observations, okay? Supernovae they are not crucial for neutrino masses, but they help in measuring better other parameters, such as, for instance, the matter density, okay? And therefore, the degenesis is shrinked and is better to extract the neutrino masses, okay? So Planck TT plus low E plus Lenzing 0.24 plus VO 0.12. If we add supernovae plus 11, if we add SDSS 4, 0.099, careful here. This is adding the controversial measurement of the Hubble parameter, okay? As you know, I didn't mention you. If I have time or if you have interest, I'll explain you later on. There is a huge inconsistency in VO measurements, okay? CMB measurements, high resid measurements, indicate that H0 is of the order of 67, 68 kilometers per second. And local measurements from supernovae and from cepheids indicate that H0, the Hubble constant, is 73. So when one has two data which are in tension, to combine them is not very good because you cannot really rely on your results because you are combining things that are not very friend, right? It's like if you put two friends together two enemies together in a small room. So I mean, let's see what it results, right? I mean, the result can be really a disaster, right? So I mean, I usually don't like to combine data when they show attention, but this is what you will get if you add also an H0 measurement from the cepheid, from the HST Hubble Space Telescope measurements, okay? Okay, our dream, the future, the neutrino mass ordering and the individual neutrino masses from cosmology, okay? The future is brilliant. We will have DESI, the dark energy instrument, which is, will be an upgrade. It has already started taking data. It's the Big Boss. It was named the Big Boss experiment. It's a ground-based telescope, okay? And it has started already collecting data. DESI here and Planck. We will also have Euclid, the Euclid satellite, okay? So here I show you for the inverted ordering in blue, and for the normal ordering in red, right, the individual neutrino masses, three of them, okay, as a function, right, of the total mass, right. I assume that the neutrinos that each neutrino has a mass, right, and then I compute some mu, okay, for the normal and inverted ordering. As you can see, with the error that these experiments are going to achieve, that is 0.02 in the neutrino masses, there won't be a way at all of measuring the individual neutrino masses, right? Because here is a mess of overlapping. Maybe the ordering, yes, because I mean, here it's clear that there are some patterns in the blue and in the red, right? And if we are able to measure the neutrino mass with 0.02 eV, maybe we are able to extract the ordering at 2 sigma if the neutrinos have the minimum mass allowed by cosmology, 0.06. But individual neutrino masses, you see, I mean, they are, I mean, it's impossible. I mean, the error bars, these regions are completely overlapping. Let's go further in future. Let's go to the Vera Rubin Observatory, LSST, okay, which will achieve to combine with Euclid and also a future CMB experiment, CORE, right, or CMB stage 4, and also DESI and Euclid. And let's add all of them. We are already in 2030 or farther away, okay? So the neutrino mass will be measured with a precision of 0.01 eV. So notice that now we could be lucky and be able to extract these two, right? Here, if the neutrino mass, if there is a normal ordering, we will have two very light and one, sorry, ups, and one very heavy. If we have the inverted ordering in blue here, we will have one very light and two quite heavy. But the neutrino hierarchy here will be really well measured, right? I mean, we are distinguishing these blues from this red, but the individual neutrino masses don't, because look at this blue curve overlapping with this other, so no way, okay? So we really need to go to this situation to extract the neutrino masses, to achieve, an error. I mean the individual neutrino masses, what is M1, M2, and M3, imagine. I mean, so we really need to achieve an error on the neutrino mass of 0.005 eV. What is that? I mean, because realize that at some point, galaxies There won't be more galaxies to observe. I mean, already DESI is going to cover up two redshifts of whatever, right? I mean, three. So at some point, we will have mapped all the galaxies in the universe. So, I mean, we can keep observing, but they will be the same. I mean, so no way. What can we do? Okay, this is the future. The 21 centimeter cosmology, okay? The cosmology of the 21st century, okay? So let me explain you this plot. So it's a plot from this reference. So we are here in the center of this plot, okay? This is what we have been measured with galaxy surveys, okay? This is the last scattering surface, right? So realize that at most with galaxy surveys, right? Well, this is not true. This was a slow digital sky survey. We are up now here, up to here, more or less. We can reach up to three, but no more. So all this universe is invisible because there are no galaxies. Galaxies start forming around here, we think, okay? What do we need? Okay, we need a 21 centimeter line because hydrogen is the most abundant element in the universe. So the 21 centimeter line is this spin flip line, right? The hyperfine line transition in the neutral hydrogen. And this will let us explore all this, and there will be plenty of information there, okay? So let me show you this briefly, okay? So as I have told you, the 21 centimeter line is a transition in the neutral hydrogen. And there is plenty of hydrogen in the universe, right? And can be measured either in emission or in absorption. But the most important thing is that this all part, starting for, this is redshift, okay? Look at the redshift, okay? Here. The universe won't be visible for us up to redshifts of 7 or 8, because from now on, the universe will be invisible. There won't be quasars, there won't be galaxies, but there is plenty of hydrogen, and there is plenty of hydrogen in which we can measure this transition, okay? This transition has a frequency of radio, so we need radio experiments to detect this, okay? Radio interferometers. And here I come to the largest, to what will be the largest interferometer on Earth, right? The square kilometer array. It will be composed by 2000 high and mid frequency disks plus a 1 million frequency antennas with an effective collecting area of 1 million meter squares. That's why kilometer square. Here is an animation of one place in the world where these radio antennas are gonna be located. Imagine that the effective area will be like to have just one plate of 1 kilometer square. Here I show you a nice picture they have, I don't know why this is not visible, but okay, I'll explain you here. This, of course, radio telescopes can't be located in the center of New York, right? Because I mean, the contamination there will be crazy. So you have to go to places with very, very low noise, right? For instance, Australia, Greenland, New Zealand. So these are some aborigines from the, it's called the Wajarri Yamaji people, right? Who signed an indigenous land use agreement, okay? To keep their culture and such, right? So here I saw you, right? The places in the world with less density of people, right? So I mean, one should go to Namibia, Mongolia, and it's precisely where this detector is gonna be located, right? I mean, Greenland is fine, but I mean, it's more, you know, the weather conditions are not that nice there. So I mean, it's better to have radio telescopes there, right? So I mean, some fun facts, the data collected by the square kilometer array in one day would just take 2 million years to be, to be reproduced in an iPod, will be so sensitive that we'll detect an iPod radar on a planet 10, tens of light years away from us. The computer will have, well, I mean, the central computer will have an enormous amount of required processing power, right? The dishes, I mean, the antennas will produce 10 times the global internet traffic, and will use enough optical fiber to wrap twice around the Earth. So it's really a mega project, okay? So Here I saw you. Where are we today, right? Here I saw you the total mass of the neutrinos versus the M-beta measurements as measured tritium beta decay experiments measure. Okay, Katrin, for instance, here we have the limit of Katrin and Katrin sensitivity. Here we have the predictions for normal and inverted ordering. For normal in red, and inverted in blue. You see that the mass in beta starts earlier here, and then also the mass of the neutrinos, right? 0.06, 0.10, right here. The total mass of the neutrinos versus in beta. This is where we are today, right? From basically, we are a bit down, but okay. I mean, 0.11, 0.10, okay? This is Katrin, and this is what we are expecting from future Cosmo. So realize that future cosmological measurements are going to be able to test this minimum neutrino mass. Careful, a different thing will be to extract the individual neutrino masses. I'm talking about the total mass, M1, mass, plus M2, plus M3, okay? Then we have also M-beta-beta, okay? This is what neutrino less double beta decay experiments measure. And as you know here, the predictions are thicker because we have the Majorana phases, right? So I mean, the parameter space is different, right? So we are exploring different parameters here. Here, there is the current limit from Kamlan-Zen, right? On this M beta beta. And the next generation sensitivity from future experiments, baryon tagging and such, is expected to reach this limit, okay? And here, the usual plot versus M-lightest, okay? And again, the cosmological limits and the future Cosmo. So future is brilliant. Let's see if you guys is able to measure the individual neutrino masses, because obviously at that time I hope to be retired, by the way, so I mean. So let me finish with take home messages, okay? And with the hands-on session 3, okay? So, neutrino masses and ineffective, that is the abundance, how many neutrinos, right? Abundances, I mean ineffective. Leave key signatures in cosmological observables, okay? We have seen that they leave key signatures in the case of ineffective in BBN and CMB, in the case of neutrino masses in CMB and large scale structure. Very important, there are no hints so far for neutrino masses or extra radiation species from cosmological data. So cosmological data or cosmological measurements or observations are perfectly consistent with zero neutrino mass, okay? Because what we are putting is an upper limit and three massless neutrinos, okay? So how do we measure an effective at the Big Bang nucleosynthesis? Via light element abundances. We have seen that in the early universe, in the first 3 minutes of the universe, 180 seconds, light elements are produced, deuterium, helium, helium-4, helium-3, and a bit of lithium, a very, very, very tiny fraction of beryllium. But the most important thing was helium, because helium, the helium abundance, is directly proportional to the neutron-to-proton ratio, and the neutron-to-proton ratio reaction frees out earlier or later, depending on the amount of radiation, total radiation in the universe, okay, given by ineffective. We have seen also that we can also extract an effective at the CMB, which cosmic microwave background measurements. But we have seen that this was at the highest multiples in the CMB damping tail, because in the first peak and around the first peak, it was completely degenerate with other effects. An effective is basically 2.99 plus with 95% confidence level error bars of 0.3, 0.35. From 2018 Planck temperature and polarization and lensing measurements, and notice that is perfectly consistent with 3 and also with BBN measurements as well from deuterium, from helium, sorry, from helium. Also, we can combine deuterium, but okay. Cosmology, now concerning neutrino masses, cosmology provides, we have seen just this, right? Sorry, yes, here, right? That cosmology today provides the strongest limit to the sum of the neutrino masses, okay? Of course, notice that it's an indirect limit, right? It's not a direct measurement. So it's true that it's the tightest bound, but it's also indirect, okay? It's not as M-beta, okay? M-beta is a really measurement of defective electron mass, right? Electron neutrino mass, sorry. So there are not so many assumptions about other cosmological parameters, and we have seen that we have also the nonlinearities and biases. So I mean, even if cosmological observations are extremely predictive today and in agreement with the Lambda-CDM universe, it's just a minimal assumption. So relaxing the assumption of a Lambda-CDM universe can relax the cosmological bounds, okay? So neutrino masses at the CMB, we have seen that there was this early ISW effect in the first peak suppression, but this is mostly degenerate with other effects, right? Also the shift was degenerate with the Hubble parameter. So the most important thing is the gravitational lensing, the CMB lensing, okay? Because the CMB photons will be distorted by lensing. And at large scale structure, due to the fact that neutrinos have a free streaming scale, they are hot relics, not as cold dark matter, right? So the tightest bound today we have in the literature, right, is 0.099 eV from Planck temperatural lensing plus this measurement. I finished a couple of weeks ago a paper with some collaborators. We found a slightly more relaxed, tighter bound was 0.09 eV, was adding quasars, right? But I mean, keep that number in mind, 0.12, 0.10, right? Okay, it can be also 0.9, but okay. I mean, keep in mind 0.10 basically from very robust combination, because this has not into account the Hubble parameter. We can go down, but then these are data which are in tension. So keep this number, but also keep in mind that even though if they are the tightest bounds to neutrino masses, they are indirect and they rely on a number of cosmological assumptions, okay? So
One question before you go on, maybe.
Yeah, of course. I was just saying thank you in many languages. And no, I have to still to give them homework. So, but yeah, tell me.
Okay, thank you first. The second is a question from Andrea Mayorga. She's asking, why can we only measure the sum of the masses instead of each of them individually?
Ah, okay, because this is what I've shown you before. Because I mean, okay, let me tell you this. Let me explain you this better. To be able to extract the neutrino masses, what we have seen is that the neutrino masses, right, induce a cut in the power spectrum, right? They reduce the power spectrum. So each mass will induce a cut at a different place. This is what was asking yesterday Marcus, right? Like each mass will be imprinted in a different scale. But to be able to see this kink somehow in the power spectrum, you have to measure the power spectrum with an extremely good accuracy. This is what I've shown here. Let me go to the slide, okay? Here, this maybe I've been too fast here, okay? So notice that this will be with future experiments. So here I'm showing you, okay? Here I'm showing you the three masses for normal and inverted. You can see, for instance, let's focus on the normal case, on the normal inverted, and the normal hierarchy, okay? We will have two very light massive neutrinos here, which are determined by this dash and this dot dash lines, and one heavy that is defined here by these dot lines, right? So you can see, right, that, and then these color regions show the errors that we are gonna have measuring this. So we won't be able to distinguish to measure them individually. The errors are too big. However, sorry, if we go to 21 centimeter measurements, you can really see that this mass eigenstate is completely decoupled from this. The error bars, focus only on the normal ordering, okay? Focus only on the red curves, okay? So you see that these error bars don't overlap with these ones. So we should be able to measure the neutrino masses, but for that we will need an extremely well precision on the power spectrum and therefore on the masses, okay? That now we cannot reach. We cannot see these individual kinks, okay? It's really, really a huge and difficult measurement, okay? It's a really difficult measurement.
So in this plot that you're showing, I have curiosity, are you using the information from the delta M squares?
Yes. That's why the two of them are here, and in the other one is here. Yes.
But these are like future projections. So by the time you can measure sigma at 0.005, you're also projecting how much better you will measure delta M squared by then, right?
Well, no, but realize that the delta M squared is only the difference between this one and this one. These two, for instance, in the case of solar, it's like 0.008 MeV, right? Mm-hmm. So this won't be, I mean, of course, between these two, you won't be able, but between these two and this one, yes, okay?
Okay, but there, my question is, are you, in your energy, sorry, in your error budget, are you also factoring in the error budget of the delta M squares?
Yes, 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 but it's a, okay. Minimal, it's a minimal one, because here, okay, it's coming only from cosmology, okay?
So yeah, thank you.
I mean, it's very difficult. It's the dream of each neutrino physicist. Of course, there are all other ways. For instance, I don't know if we are able to measure the kinks in the beta, in the tritium beta decay, or even the in the neutrino less double beta decay, right? In the capture of Ptolemy or something like this, right? But these are really, really future as this is, of course, right? So I mean, it's very difficult to extract the individual values of the neutrino mass. And you are able to see only the overall effect. Just that there is a suppression induced by the three of them, not one starts here, then the other, right? So I mean, so let me give you the homework. We were here, right? So yeah, well, I mean, this is something that you can use also just to play. And well, no, I prefer I did this, right? So you go here, okay? This is a toolbox, okay, that in which you can compute the CLs and also the power spectrum for different parameters, also for different neutrino masses. In this case, I'm asking you to compute the power spectrum and the CLs for different neutrino masses, for this sum of neutrino masses, and change some of the other cosmological parameters, okay? So you go to this webpage that is there, right? Or you will put this, right? Type it, and you go to this. Okay, so we want linear, okay? Let's keep linear. We want lensing, we want the CLs, right? We want also, let me see, the transfer function. You need to do this to put the power spectrum, right? Okay, and then here you can change everything. You can change even the neutrino mass splitting, the number of eigenstates. If you put one, it will be only one mass eigenstate. You can put three, of course, the degeneracies, mass fractions, and omega nu h squared. So omega nu h squared is the sum of the neutrinos divided by 93. Okay, 100. So if I want the minimal schedule, which is 0.06, I have to put 0.06 divided by 100, right? Okay, then in effect, you can also change this here, massive neutrinos 1, massless neutrinos 3. Let's put here, for instance, massless neutrinos 0 and 3 massive neutrinos, okay? Perfect, and the minimum neutrino mass. So you can do and go, okay, go, very good. Now it's running. If not, you can check this where all your data will be collected. If in a minute it's not, we can go to here, right? And then you will have here the output, right? So you have here the age of the universe today, the amplitude of the fluctuations. For a neutrino mass, I've put 3 degenerate at 0.02, okay? The total mass is 0.06, which is what matters, right? I mean, so here you see the CLs, right? The temperature, polarization, and the data of the matter power spectrum, you can download it, okay? Just download this data, right? We can download it here, let me see, okay? I can, and let me see, I can download it. If I can download it, I guess so, right? So I have here, well, I don't know, anyways, okay. So you can download this data, and then you can come back and save it, and you can come back and increase the neutrino mass and see what happens, okay, and plot all of them together. For instance, I want a neutrino mass of 0.3. This will mean that omega nu h squared should be around 0.003. I have to divide by 100 to compute omega nu h squared, okay, because omega nu h squared is sum of nu divided by 100, roughly, okay, the sum of nu in EV. So, and then I compute it again. And then once that you have done all this, you can plot all of them together, right? And change also some of the other cosmological parameters, as the, for instance, Hubble constant, as I have told you, that is strongly degenerate, or omega nu h squared, or the helium fraction, or change the number of massless neutrinos and massive neutrinos, okay? So this is a very useful way of computing the CLs if you have a model, even if you are not working with neutrinos again, as the other day with Vivian, and you have a model in which you have a different reservoir reionization, I don't know, or a different dark matter here, the dark matter omega VH, or a different baryon energy density, or a different matter energy density, okay, or curvature. So you will be able to do your your plots, your predictions for the cosmic microwave background and power spectrum, and to collect the data and download it and do beautiful plots. And also you can also download afterwards Planck points and plot it on top of this. In the sense that it's very useful because you don't need to install anything, right? So you just go here and then you just run it and then you download the data files or whatever you want. So what I suggest is to play around with this CAM file, right? With this CAM application and see what happens if you change the neutrino mass and change, for instance, let's say the Hubble parameter, if you can replace one with the other. And the answer concerning CMB is gonna be yes, concerning the Hubble, the power spectrum will be no, but okay. So I mean, you have here some examples of how to play with and such, okay? So now I'm finished with the lectures. I'll be connected to the discussion session this afternoon for sure. And if you have questions, please feel free to ask me, to send me emails, to whatever. I'm not very familiar with this Gather stuff. I'm not very familiar with these things, right? I mean, I'm neither familiar with Twitter, so imagine. I stopped in Facebook. My life has stopped in Facebook, so. It's my daughter, the one who helps me to do these Twitter things that, I mean, when I something has to, I'm in charge of the outreach and the dissemination of my institute. So many times I have to tweet something and I'm like, Sophia, I have to tweet something. I'm completely useless on that. But I will be more than happy to reply to your emails and whatever, I mean, so.
Thank you so much, Olga. I ask everybody to please unmute for a second and just let's thank Olga, clapping for a bit.
Thank you. I will be with you this afternoon, thank you. I will be with you this afternoon, though, unfortunately, okay?
Thank you.
And if I have some time, I'll connect also to other talks, I promise.
Excellent.
So far, excellent. I have some sort of difficulties, but okay, I'll try my best, okay?
Perfect, thank you. And we have a few minutes for questions, so...
Yeah, please.
If you have one, please go ahead. You can also unmute yourself and ask.
Maybe while people are thinking about questions, we can aim for our photo, our summer school photo that we wanted to.
Sure. So for that, Olga, you need to stop sharing for a second.
It's true. Because you know the photo is gonna be from off my screen, of course.
Yeah. Which are, I like your slides, yeah, so.
And it would be good if also like the students just for this photo would be showing their faces if you're in a presentable state.
No, but this is very common, lady. I mean, you are wearing your pyjamas down and up, you are like, okay. Right? I mean, you are like going to a party and then down you have your pyjamas. Well, not okay. Now, but last year we used to be like this.
So, thank you, I see that a lot of students now. Good to see you.
I'll take a screenshot, the first one, in 1, 2, one, two, three. Let me go to the next screen. That's 1, 2, 3. Okay, I think that does it. Let me check that I actually took the right pictures. Just give me a second.
I've also made screenshots.
Yeah, those look good. So we are set. Thank you so very much. You can go back to turning your camera off if you want to. But okay, so we still have a few minutes for questions. I think I maybe to get us started, I actually have one curiosity. And I've always seen that for this cosmological fits, they have like 200 free parameters and that or so, a lot of them are nuisance parameters, but they're very sensitive to the priors that you choose, right? The results are sensitive to the priors we choose on the parameters when making the fits to the cosmological data. And I always wondered why is that? So if you choose a log prior on some parameter versus a linear prior on some parameter, you get different results. Is there a simple explanation as to why?
Okay. This is, especially for the neutrino mass, this is very important, okay? So, I mean, this is a question of parameter space, okay? I can try to... Let me see if I'm able to find this. I can show you this. Keyword I don't know if it's called like this or NuFNAL or something like this. Wow. Let me see. Okay, I should have this, but I don't know if it's in this one or not. But I should have this at some point because I explained this because Steven Parke asked me to explain this explicitly. So, but I don't know if it's this one or, I mean, this is the usual thing. I don't know where I have this. Where was this? 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 No, one second. Because I can explain you this better if I show you a plot with the parameter space allowed.
Sure.
In one or the other. Is that okay giving password? Okay, let me see if it's this in here. Okay. I don't know why I don't have the keynote of this, but okay. Okay. Yeah, here it is, right? Yeah. Yeah. So I mean, yeah, that we observe, right, that depending on the priors, right, can be a logarithmic or linear, right? So the one
you need to share your screen, Olga.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Sorry. I'm going. So I found this. So share the screen, perfect, okay. You can see this now, share. Okay, here, I apologize. You can see this here, right? Let me make this larger. Okay, well, I mean, not so large, but okay. So I mean, okay. Yeah, this is what I call, that is prior time, right? It's prior dependent, right? So I mean, the thing is that the indication for normal versus inverted hierarchy in normal versus logarithmic scale, okay? So you can see that the indication from cosmology, right, is weak if you consider basically a linear, right, here, right? However, if you consider logarithm priors, right, and this parametrization, because there are two possible parametrization, right, either m1, m2, or m3, or m lighter, delta m squared and delta m squared, you can get very different results. So the point here is that if you consider, you explore the parameter space in terms of M1, M2, and M3, and you assume a logarithmic prior on them, you are shifting your results. Why? Because this is the available volume space for normal versus inverted in normal, when you do a linear thing and when you do a logarithmic, right? So notice that there is a huge difference, right, in the volume here for the normal versus inverted in the case of logarithmic. Well, in the case of linear, it's almost the same, right? So the available volume for M2, M1, and M3 in the case of linear and in the case of logarithmic priors is much different. So then you will have a clear preference, right, for normal ordering due to this different volume. If you adopt the linear parametrization, you see that there won't be such a difference, right, between normal and inverted, right, for any of these masses, right? So I mean, this is because of the available volume induced by the prior. So you have to be very careful, because if your evidence here is coming from the prior, this is not good, right? So I mean, we did this study and we conclude that indeed, if you do linear stuff, this never happens. You never have this, right? You look at this. You never have this, right? Never ever, right? Never. There is never a strong evidence for hierarchy, right? And moreover, the only strong evidence that we have today, well, it's not strong, but the 3-2 point whatever sigma evidence that we have, or 2 point, is coming from oscillation data, not from cosmological data. From cosmological data, it's impossible that we are able to have this. Why? Because for that, precisely, you have to measure you have to distinguish this from this. And for that, you have to measure this with different from this with a small error bar, right? So, I mean, we need really future experiments to measure the hierarchy future and to measure the individual neutrino masses even further in the future, okay? So far we have arrived here, but this does not mean that you rule out the inverted hierarchy, right? Because you have not measured that, or the other way around, right? Okay, so, okay, is the prior, so one should be very careful about the prior, okay?
Excellent, thank you. So I suggest that we go for lunch. So we actually have time for lunch, and then we can ask Olga if we have any other questions by the discussion or
by email. Sure, I'll be at 4:30 here, okay?
Excellent. So thanks, everybody. Thanks, Olga, again, You're so welcome. Very much. This has been great, and I hope that we can see you in person in the not very distant future. Like we should have this time. Hope. And everybody else, we meet at 1:30 here on Zoom, and see you all later.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.